In this videotape, we're going to practice evaluating limits at infinity and infinite limits. Before we get started, I want to go over some basic ideas that you've probably covered in your class. If k is a constant and r is a positive integer, then the limit of k over x to the r as x approaches infinity plus infinity is 0, as well as the limit of k over x to the r as x approaches minus infinity is 0. In either case, the numerator is fixed, it's a constant. The bottom, okay, is getting very large in absolute value. Okay, it can get very positive or very negative, I don't care, but the numerator is fixed, the bottom is blowing up, either very positive or very negative. Something fixed over something huge is going to go to 0. The other fact that I want to go over with you is that if the limit of g of x as x approaches a is 0, and if the limit of f of x as x approaches a is some constant k that's not 0, here k is a constant that's not 0, then the limit of f of x over g of x as x approaches a, let's see what's happening. The bottom is going to 0, the top is approaching a constant which is not 0. This is important. The bottom is going to 0, the top is not 0. This limit does not exist. It might be plus infinity or minus infinity if we have some more information about whether x is approaching a from the right or left. That would depend on whether the bottom goes to 0 through positive or negative values, whether the constant is positive or negative. We'll be doing some examples. But the important thing is that the limit does not exist. Okay? Does not exist in the infinite sense. It will be either plus or minus infinity, and we'll discuss the sign of the infinity later on. But right now, if the bottom goes to 0 and the top doesn't, that limit does not exist. It will be infinite. Okay. Okay, let's try some examples. For our first example, let's look at the limit of 7 over x minus 2 as x approaches 2 from the right side. X is approaching 2 through values that are larger than 2. Okay, first of all, as x approaches 2, the bottom here is approaching 0. And the top, of course, is going to stay 7. So we have a situation of a fraction here where the bottom is going to 0 and the top is a constant which is not 0, or approaching a constant which is not 0. Now we know that this limit does not exist. But we have the ability to figure out in what sense does it not exist. As x approaches 2 from the right, let's look at a sample testing value. For example, 2.1. As we're looking at the number line, here is 2. When we're approaching it from the right, we're looking at numbers that are greater than 2. For example, here is 3, and we're looking now at 2.1. If I was approaching 2 from the left, I might use 1.9 as a testing value. I'm looking at a number that's close to 2, but from the right side of 2, on the right of 2. Now, all you have to do is determine what is happening here in the denominator. It's approaching 0, but when you're approaching it as x approaches 2 from the right, the values you're substituting are larger than 2. For example, 2.1 minus 2 is positive. So you're getting close to 0, but the whole time you're staying positive. And of course, the numerator here is positive. Positive over positive, so we can say plus infinity for the answer to this problem. As we know, the limit does not exist. It's going to be infinite. If we want to figure out the sign of the infinity, because we're approaching 2 from the right, we have enough information. Get a testing value, substitute in the testing value, whatever the sign of this expression is at the testing value, in this case positive over positive, that will be the sign of the infinity. Let's try another example. Suppose we want to look at the limit of 2 over 5 minus x as x approaches 5 from the right side. Okay, as x approaches 5, once again, the bottom is approaching 0, the top is not 0, so the answer, the limit does not exist, and it's going to be infinite, and we want to figure out the sign of the infinity. I look at a testing value, something that's close to 5, but from the right side, something that's larger than 5, for example, 5.1. And I substitute in, I get 2 over 5 minus 5.1, positive over negative. It's positive and the bottom is negative, so positive over negative gives us minus infinity here for the answer. Some people mistakenly believe that when you approach from the right, it's going to be plus infinity. When you approach from the left, it's minus infinity. That's nonsense. Okay? Each problem has to be worked out separately. You first determine if the bottom goes to 0, the top doesn't, then it's going to be infinite, the answer. And then to figure out the sign of the infinity, you figure out, you use a testing value, and whatever the sign of the expression is at the testing value, that's the sign of the infinity. Let's try another example. The limit as x approaches 2 from the right of 3x squared minus 12 over x minus 2. Okay, in this case, as x approaches 2, the bottom goes to 0, but unlike the previous problems that we'd worked out, as x approaches 2, the top is also going to 0. 3 times 2 squared, 3 times 4, 12 minus 12 is 0. Okay, we can't use the rule that we just used on the other problems, because in the other problems, the bottom was going to 0, but the top wasn't going to 0. Okay, the bottom was going to 0, the top stayed 2, or the bottom was going to 0, the top stayed 7. Here, the bottom is going to 0, and the top is going to 0. So the rule that we used can't be used. When the numerator and the denominator are both going to 0, we have what we call a 0 over 0 form. It's called an indeterminate form, meaning that I can't make a decision at this stage. Anything can happen. Maybe it'll have a finite limit, and maybe it won't. Maybe the limit will exist, maybe it won't. But I can't make a decision in this form. And what I'm going to try to do is to see if I can somehow modify the form. In this particular problem, the reason that both the numerator and the denominator are going to 0 as x approaches 2 is that it happens that x minus 2 is a factor both of the numerator and the denominator. If we try to factor the numerator, 3 times x squared minus 4, the denominator is just x minus 2. The x squared minus 4 can further factor into x plus 2 times x minus 2 because it's a difference of squares. And now we see that, as I said before, the reason that both the numerator and the denominator were going to 0 as x approached 2 is that x minus 2 is a factor in the numerator and the denominator. And as such, we can divide numerator and denominator by x minus 2. Remember, as x approaches 2, it's just getting close to 2. It's not equal to 2. Because of that, x minus 2 is not 0, and we can divide numerator and denominator by x minus 2. And now we have changed the problem into an equivalent problem whose limit we can find by substitution, because as x approaches 2 here, we have function which is continuous at 2, and we can find its limit by substitution, and we get 3 times 2 plus 2, 3 times 4, or 12, as an answer. So let's go back and look at the problems that we've done so far. In the first problem, the bottom was going to 0, but the top wasn't. In the second also, the bottom was going to 0 and the top wasn't. We knew in both cases the limit did not exist. It was infinite, but we had to figure out the sign of the infinity, and we used a testing value. An appropriate value in this case was 2.1. Whatever the sign was at 2.1, that was the sign of the infinity. Here we use 5.1, and since when you substitute in 5.1, you get plus over minus, it came out to be minus infinity. Okay, but in the third problem, not only was the bottom going to 0, but the top was also going to 0, and that rule was not valid, and instead what we did is modify the form of the problem. We suspected that they might have a factor in common that could be canceled out, which was counting for the fact that both of numerator and the denominator were both going to zero, and in fact, x minus 2 was a factor, top and bottom. We canceled them out, and we found the limit now of the modified problem. Okay, let's try another example. The limit of x minus 5 over 2 as x approaches 5 from the right. Once again, here we can find our limit by substitution. This is a continuous function. And as such, to find the limit as x approaches 5, let's just let x be 5. 0 over 2 is 0. I want you to remember that a 0 upstairs is not a problem. It's the 0 downstairs that's a problem. If the bottom goes to 0 and the top doesn't, then the limit is going to be infinite. However, if the top goes to 0 and the bottom goes to 2, 0 over 2 is just 0. Let's try another example. The limit of 2 over 5 minus x as x approaches 5 from the left. Here, as x approaches 5, the bottom is going to 0. The top isn't. It's staying 2, or you could say approaches 2. But the point is, the bottom is going to 0, the top doesn't. It's going to be infinite. The limit does not exist, and we want to figure out the sign of the infinity. We need a testing value, a number that's close to 5, but on the left side of 5, that's less than 5. We can use 4.9. We substitute in 4.9. 2 over 5 minus 4.9, positive over positive, and the answer is plus infinity. Because 5 minus 4.9, it's going to go to 0, but it's going to be positive the whole time, and of course 2 is positive. Plus over plus is plus infinity. Okay, for our next example, which is number 6, let's try the following. The limit as x approaches 5 from the right, 2x squared minus 50 over x minus 5. Now, as x approaches 5, here's the case, the bottom is going to 0, and the top is also going to 0 because we have 2 times 25, 50 minus 50 is going to 0. So we have an indeterminate form, and we have to do more work before we can make a decision. And what we can do here is to factor the numerator, take out a 2, and be left with x squared minus 25. And then if we further factor, the x squared minus 25, a difference of squares, into x plus 5 times x minus 5. We're using, for example, a squared minus b squared is a plus b times a minus b. At this point, as x approaches 5, x is just getting close to 5. It's not equal to 5. X minus 5 is not 0. And we can divide numerator and denominator by x minus 5. So we get the limit of 2 times x plus 5 as x approaches 5 from the right. And it's a continuous function. We can find the limit by substitution. 2 times 5 plus 5, or 2 times 10, for an answer of 20. Now let's compare this problem with problem 7, where we're doing the limit as x approaches 5 from the right, but now of 2x minus 10 over x squared minus 10x plus 25. Now as x approaches 5, the bottom is approaching 5 squared, which is 25 minus 50 plus 25. 50 minus 50. The bottom is approaching 0. And the top is approaching 2 times 5, 10 minus 10, also approaching 0. So once again, we have an indeterminate form. And we want to see if we can modify this expression, and we can, in fact, factor the numerator and the denominator. On the top, we can factor out a common factor of 2, leaving us with 2 times x minus 5. On the bottom, we have a trinomial that can be factored into 2 binomials, looking for 2 numbers that multiply to plus 25 but add to minus 10, and they are minus 5 and minus 5. Let's just check this, see if we did it correctly. X squared. First, x squared outer, minus 5x inner, minus 5x last, plus 25. FOIL, right? First, outer, inner, last. So x squared minus 10x plus 25. Okay, once again, as x approaches 5, x is not equal to 5, x minus 5 is not 0, and we can divide numerator and denominator by x minus 5. We get the limit of 2 over x minus 5 as x approaches 5 from the right. In this problem now, as x approaches 5, now the bottom is going to 0 still, but the top is no longer going to 0. The top is staying 2. Well, if the bottom is going to 0 and the top isn't going to 0, the limit is not going to exist and the limit is infinite. And let's figure out the sign of the infinity. Let's look at a testing value, a number that's close to 5, but from the right. So a number that's close to 5 but larger than 5, for example, 5.1. If we substitute in 5.1, 2 is positive over 5.1 minus 5, which is positive, positive over positive. So the result is plus infinity. Now, what I would like to have you note here is that we were looking at two problems that started off 0 over 0 form. We call the 0 over 0 form an indeterminate form, meaning I can't tell what's going to happen and anything can happen. Okay? People tend to be used to problems like this. Oh, it's 0 over 0, but we can fix it up and make it nice. Well, this one was 0 over 0, but after we factored and canceled, we did get a nice problem, and the limit came out to be a finite number. However, it can also happen that you start off with 0 over 0, as we did in this case, and what happens eventually? The limit does not exist. Eventually here, when we reduce, we wound up with something that the bottom went to 0 and the top no longer went to 0, and this limit did not exist. So when I say 0 over 0 is indeterminate, I mean it. I mean, you really can't assume that the answer will be nice. You just don't know at this stage what's going to happen. It may come out nice. It may not exist. You certainly can't tell from the original problem the way it's stated. You have to work it through. Okay, we've been concentrating on problems involving infinite limits. Now let's work out some problems involving limits at infinity. By this I mean that we're going to be taking the limit as x approaches infinity, in this case x approaches plus infinity, of 3x cubed plus 2x squared plus 4 over 5x cubed plus 7x plus 3. Okay, we're taking the limit at infinity as x approaches infinity. Now, in order to do this problem, let's just go back over here and glance at these things that I wrote down earlier. If k is a constant and r is a positive integer, the limit of k over x to the r as x approaches either plus or minus infinity is going to be 0. But if you have something fixed over something that's blowing up, fixed over blowing up, the result is going to go to 0. Let's see how we can use that. Now, in this particular case, what we have is something that's blowing up over something that's blowing up. The top and the bottom are both getting very large. There's a way to modify this so that we can use the idea that I just showed you. And the trick is to look for the highest power of x present in the problem. In this case, of course, it's x cubed. And what we're going to do is we're going to divide numerator and denominator by x cubed. In other words, divide numerator and denominator by the highest power of x present in the problem. Divide numerator and denominator by x cubed. What we've done effectively is to multiply by 1. That's always allowed. Whatever we're doing to the top, we're doing to the bottom as well. You can't divide the top, say, by x cubed and the bottom by x squared. Whatever you pick as the highest power, the top and the bottom get divided by it. Now, the limit is x approaches plus infinity. If you're going to divide the top by x cubed, that means each term gets divided by x cubed. 3x cubed over x cubed plus 2x squared over x cubed plus 4 over x cubed divided by, now, the bottom is also going to get divided by x cubed. So 5x cubed divided by x cubed plus 7x divided by x cubed plus 3 divided by x cubed. Make it a little neater here, limit as x approaches plus infinity. This is the limit as x approaches plus infinity. Let's clean this up a little. 3x cubed over x cubed is 3, plus 2x squared over x cubed is 2 over x, plus 4 over x cubed, divided by 5x cubed over x cubed is 5, plus 7x over x cubed is 7 over x squared, plus 3 over x cubed. The limit as x approaches plus infinity. Now let's look what happens. Because we divided by the highest power of x present in the problem, every term either stayed a constant or became something in the form k over x to the r. Okay, the terms that had the highest power, when you divided by the highest power, became constant. All the other terms involved less than the highest power. When you divided by the highest power, you wound up with x in the denominator. So each one is in the form k over x to the r, k over x to the r. Now, from this over here, we know that anything in the form k over x to the r, as x approaches plus or minus infinity, k over x to the r is going to go to 0. So let's see what happens. It's the limit of the top over the limit of the bottom. 3 stays 3, but this is in the form k over x to the r is going to go to 0. This is going to go to the 0. This is going to 0. And this is going to 0. So if the top is going to 3 plus 0 plus 0, it's going to 3. If the bottom is going to 5 plus 0 plus 0, it's going to 5. And the answer is going to be 3/5. By the way, in this problem, it wouldn't have mattered if x approached minus infinity. Everything would have been the same. Sometimes it does matter, and we'll see that later on. But right now, if x approached minus infinity, we'd be still using the k over x to the r idea. And whether x approaches plus or minus infinity, k over x to the r is going to go to 0. Okay, let's look at another example. Problem 9, the limit as x approaches plus infinity of 7 minus 4x squared over 3 plus 6x squared plus 2x. The highest power of x present in the problem is x squared. We're going to divide top and bottom by x squared. Seven gets divided by x squared minus 4x squared over x squared becomes minus 4 over 3 divided by x squared plus 6x squared divided by x squared is 6 plus 2x divided by x squared becomes 2 over x. Each term got divided by x squared. So we have basically multiplied by 1, which hasn't changed anything. Now, anything in the form k over x to the r is going to go to 0 as x approaches plus infinity or minus infinity. So this goes to 0. This goes to 0. And this goes to 0. So the numerator is going to 0 minus 4 or minus 4. The denominator is going to 0 plus 6 plus 0 or 6. And the final answer is minus 2/3. Now, in class, some of you may have learned a shorter method for finding these limits, for evaluating these limits, to use the idea of what is happening to the problem as x gets very large, See, how does the numerator behave and how does the denominator behave? So the idea is if x is, for example, a million, it's getting very large. 3 times a million cubed is so much larger than 4, and we don't really have to think about the 4 too much. It's also much larger than 2 times a million squared. In other words, as x blows up, the numerator in this problem is basically behaving like 3x cubed. And the denominator is basically behaving like 5x cubed, because it's basically behaving like its highest power of x. So what happens? To 3x cubed over 5x cubed as x blows up, and this is approaching 3/5, which of course is the answer that we got to the problem. But you have to be careful. Some people get sloppy and they say, oh, I'm just going to take the first term that I see. That just so happens in this particular problem that the first term was the term of highest degree, the 3x cubed, the 5x cubed. In this problem over here, you can still use the behaves-like idea, but you have to understand that the numerator is going to behave like the term of highest degree. So the numerator behaves like minus 4x squared. The denominator is, looking through it, is going to behave like 6x squared. And this is going to approach minus 4/6 or minus 2/3. Which of course is the same answer that we got. So if you like that method, fine, but be careful. Don't just, you know, get sloppy and say 7/3. You have to look for the term of highest degree. And basically the numerator behaves like the term of highest degree and so does the denominator as x gets very large. But this is of course only when x is approaching plus or minus infinity. Okay, let's try another example. Problem 10, how about this, the limit as x approaches plus infinity of 2x squared plus 3x plus 2 over 4x cubed plus 5. Now, let's look for the highest power of x present in the problem. It happens to be x cubed. You have to divide numerator and denominator by the highest power, which is x cubed. You cannot divide the numerator by x squared and the denominator by x cubed, because you have to do the same thing to the top and the bottom, or you destroy the equivalence of the problem to the next one. So it's important to divide top and bottom by the highest power, whatever it is, but whatever you do to the top, you have to do to the bottom. Now, limit as x approaches plus infinity. 2x squared over x cubed is 2 over x, plus 3x over x cubed is 3 over x squared, plus 2 over x cubed. And on the bottom, 4x cubed over x cubed is 4, plus 5 over x cubed. Now let's see what happens. Anything that's in the form k over x to the r is going to go to 0. So this goes to 0. This goes to 0, this goes to 0, and this goes to 0. So the entire numerator goes to 0. The denominator goes to 4 plus 0. 0 divided by 4, that's not a problem. 0 divided by 4 is 0, and that's the answer to this problem. I do want to point out that if this had been approaching minus infinity, the answer to this problem would be the same. Okay, in fact, the last 3 problems that we did, none of them would have had a different answer if we let x approach minus infinity. Let's look at the limit as x approaches infinity of 3x squared plus 4 over 2 minus 7x. And I'm also going to, in a moment, work out the same problem, limit of 3x squared plus 4 over 2 minus 7x as x approaches minus infinity. And we'll see why in this problem it does matter and they have to be worked out separately. As I said, in the 3 preceding problems, if x approached minus infinity instead of plus infinity, the k over x to the r would come into play and the answer would come out exactly the same. But here we're going to see there's going to be a problem. We'll see in a moment why. Let's start working this out. We're looking for the highest power of x present in the problem, and it's x squared. So we're going to divide top and bottom by x squared. Each term is going to get divided by x squared. Once again, you can't be selective and use x squared upstairs and x in the bottom. Whatever you do to the top, you got to do to the bottom. Okay, 3x squared over x squared is 3, plus 4 over x squared, 2 over x squared, minus 7x over x squared is minus 7 over x. Now let's see what happens. The things that are in the form k over x to the r are going to go to 0. Now something interesting happens. The entire bottom went to 0, and the top went to 3. The bottom goes to 0, and the top does not go to 0. We know that such a limit does not exist, and in fact, it's going to be infinite. We have to figure out the sign of the infinity. This is how we started off our videotape, in fact. The bottom was going to 0 and the top wasn't. So now we have the whole bottom is going to 0, but the top is approaching 3. The bottom goes to 0, the top doesn't. The result will be infinite. The limit does not exist. Let's figure out the sign of the infinity. Now we need a testing value. We had x approaching 5 from the right, we used 5.1, or x approaching 5 from the left, we could use 4.9. For x approaching plus infinity, just pick a very large positive value for x. Okay? We can use, in fact, just plus 100 would be enough in this case. If, however, there were hundreds or thousands where the coefficients are in the problem, then I wouldn't consider 100 large. I want something that's large with respect to these coefficients. As I said, if this was plus 4 million, then 100 is not a large number. But for these numbers, 100 is larger than any of these coefficients, sufficiently large that we can look at it. In other words, it's infinity, I want a testing value, and I'm going to look at the sign. Better to do it in the original form than in the divided form. I'm going to look for the sign of the expression at the testing value, and whatever the sign is, just like before, that'll be the sign of the infinity. As x approaches plus infinity, we're using, for example, plus 100. The top 3 times 100 squared plus 4 is certainly positive. The bottom, however, 2 minus 700 is going to be negative. It's going to be plus over minus, so the answer is going to be minus infinity. Okay. For those of you who want to do this with the behave like idea, you can still do it. The top behaves like 3x squared, the bottom like minus 7x. So this is behaving like 3x over minus 7. And if we cancel one of the x's, as x approaches plus infinity, you get a very large, this the top is approaching plus infinity over the minus 7. It's going to be plus over minus. It's minus infinity. Okay, so it can still be done that way. But here we get a minus infinity for an answer. Now let's look at the same problem that we just did, but now x approaches minus infinity. We start off the same way. We're going to divide top and bottom by x squared, the highest power of x present in the problem. And the second line is the same. 3x squared over x squared is 3, and then plus 4 over x squared, 2 over x squared, minus 7 over x. Once again, anything in the form k over x to the r goes to 0, so the bottom is going to 0, the top is approaching 3, and the answer is going to be infinite. We got to figure out the sign of the infinity. Now when we use a testing value, as x approaches minus infinity, let's say we use minus 100. Plugging in minus 100 into the original expression, 3 times minus 100 squared, that's positive, plus 4, that's positive. 2 minus 7 times minus 100, minus times a minus is plus, so it's plus over plus, it's plus infinity. Okay, so the way the problem can be affected, okay, is as you approach plus or minus infinity. In this case, because the bottom went to 0 and the top didn't, you needed a testing value. It's infinite, but you needed a testing value for the sign of the infinity. And then when you use a different testing value, you might not, but you might get different answers. Sometimes it can still come out, both plus infinity or both minus infinity. Okay, but here there's a chance that the answers will come out to be different. Remember when the top and the bottom both involve the same highest power, we got a finite, we got a non-zero finite answer for the limit. When the numerator had the lower power, the denominator had the higher power, we divided by the higher power, we had like a zero over a positive, a zero over a constant that wasn't zero, and that came out to be zero. In these cases, when the top has the higher power than the bottom, it came down to a situation after we've done our division where the bottom went to zero and the top didn't, and these answers come out to be infinite. And here, to figure out the sign of the infinity, you had to use a testing value, and you could wind up with a different answer. In this problem as well, if you use the behaves-like idea, okay, this is the same. It's still behaving like 3x over minus 7, but as x approaches minus infinity, the top is going to be negative over negative, and the answer is going to be plus infinity. Okay, I'd like to give you another problem where it will matter whether x approaches plus or minus infinity. Let's look at the limit as x approaches plus infinity of the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over 5x minus 3. And I'm also going to want to work out the limit as x approaches minus infinity of the same example, the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over 5x minus 3. Now, I'm interested in dividing top and bottom by the highest power of x that occurs in the problem. Okay. You see an x in the bottom, you have an x squared in the top, but the x squared in the top is under the square root sign. So, what is the highest power of x? You can divide top and bottom by, well, if you think of the square root of x squared as basically behaving like x, you could divide top and bottom by the square root of x squared. The truth is, the square root of x squared is not x, but it's actually the absolute value of x. Okay, you probably had this in your classes. Whereas when you square the number, you obliterate whether it was positive or negative, and then you take the positive square root, it has the same effect as taking the absolute value. And in fact, the absolute value of a number, we know if a number is positive or zero, we leave it alone. But if the number is negative, we throw a minus in front of it. That's basically how we take absolute value. For example, the absolute value of 5, since 5 is greater than 0, is just 5. But the absolute value of minus 3, you put a minus in front, minus a minus 3 comes out to be plus 3. Alternately, you can, to get the absolute value of a number, square the number and take the positive square root. For example, 5 squared, 25, positive square root was 5. But minus 3, when we wanted to find its absolute value, we square it, became 9. Positive square root of 9 was plus 3. So either of these methods will give you the absolute value. Okay, now, what will this do for us? When we have in the numerator the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over the square root of x squared, we can mix them together and get the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over x squared. Because we know from algebra that the square root of a fraction is the square root of the top over the square root of the bottom. So the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over x squared is really the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over the square root of x squared. Now on the bottom we have 5x minus 3 over the square root of x squared. Now, since there's no radical in the denominator, I'd like to get out of the square root of x squared. Okay, well, the square root of x squared is the absolute value of x, can be written as either plus x or minus x. As x approaches plus infinity, however, certainly x is going to be positive. If x is going to be positive, then the absolute value of x should rightfully be replaced by x. So when I see the square root of x squared, which is the absolute value of x in this problem, I'm going to replace it by x. On the other hand, when I work out the same problem later on as x approaches minus infinity, then I'll have to worry about this. Let's see what we can do with this now. Limit as x approaches plus infinity, the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over x squared. If you have a fraction, a bunch of terms over the same denominator, you can break it up, put each term in the numerator over the common denominator. So you can make this the square root of 9x squared over x squared plus 2 over x squared. Similarly in the denominator, we can make it instead of 5x minus 3 over x, 5x over x minus 3 over x. Cleaning this up a little bit, limit as x approaches plus infinity, the square root of 9x squared over x squared, that's 9, plus 2 over x squared. 5x over x is 5 minus 3 over x. Once again, anything in the form k over x to the r is going to go to 0 as x blows up. So what happens here is the numerator approaches the square root of 9 plus 0, or the square root of 9. The denominator approaches 5 minus 0, or 5. And the final answer is plus 3/5. Now let's look at the same problem, but now as x approaches minus infinity. It starts off the same way. We're going to, just like I did over here, multiply by 1 in the form 1 over the square root of x squared over 1 over the square root of x squared. In other words, divide top and bottom by the square root of x squared. Limit as x approaches minus infinity. Square root of 9x squared plus 2 over the square root of x squared on top. And on the bottom, 5x minus 3 over. Now, this is the question. Once again, the square root of x squared is the absolute value of x, which can be written as plus x if x is positive, or minus x if x is negative. The last time we did the problem, we replaced the square root of x squared by x because x was approaching plus infinity. But now, x is approaching minus infinity. As x approaches minus infinity, certainly x is negative. If x is negative, then the square root of x squared should rightfully be replaced by minus x. So here is the place where the two problems change. Okay? In this problem, x was approaching plus infinity. The square root of x squared, which is the absolute value of x, got replaced by plus x because x is approaching plus infinity. Here, however, x is approaching minus infinity. The square root of x squared, which is the absolute value of x, is going to be replaced by minus x in this problem. Because as x approaches minus infinity, it's certainly negative, and when it's negative, the absolute value of x should be written minus x. As x approaches minus infinity, we can combine the radicals here, the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over the square root of x squared. It's the square root of 9x squared plus 2 over x squared, one radical, and that can be 9x squared over x squared plus 2 over x squared. And on the bottom here, we can rewrite this as 5x over minus x minus 3 over minus x. Cleaning it up a little, the limit as x approaches minus infinity, the square root of 9x squared over x squared is 9, plus 2 over x squared. 5x over minus x is minus 5 in this case. And then plus 3 over x. This is minus 5 plus 3 over x. So the denominator is a negative of what it was in the preceding problem. Now, the k over x to the r term is going to go to 0, leaving us with the top approaching the square root of 9, the bottom approaching minus 5, and the square root of 9 means the positive square root of 9 is 3, so the final answer is now minus 3/5. It's 3 over minus 5, or minus 3/5. So when we're taking limits at infinity, as x approaches plus or minus infinity, very often the answer doesn't the answer is not affected by whether you approach plus or minus infinity. This will be true so long as the only thing that you had to think about is the k over x to the r idea. However, we've seen two exceptions to that. One where the bottom goes to zero and the top doesn't, and the result is infinite, and you need a testing value, then it does matter whether it's plus or minus infinity, whether you plug in a plus 100 or a minus 100, for example. And the second time it does matter is when you have a mixture of, say, a radical expression and an expression without a radical, then if you're going to use the idea that the square root of x squared is the absolute value of x to get out of the radical, then the absolute value of x could be plus x or minus x, depending on whether you're approaching plus infinity or minus infinity. And that brings us to the end of this tape.